Yes, you're listening to the Hour of the Time. I'm William Cooper, and we're live tonight. Live, thanks to a miracle and some patriots in Phoenix, Arizona. Before we get started tonight, folks, make sure you're listening because this is a doozy. I want to tell you that I'm going to be in Los Angeles September the 3rd and the 4th. September the 3rd and the 4th, I'll be speaking at the Extraordinary Experiences Research Expo at the Los Angeles Airport Marina Hotel. That's September the 3rd and the 4th, 1994. Extraordinary Experiences Research Expo at the Los Angeles Airport Marina Hotel. For information, ladies and gentlemen, please call area code 213. That's area code 213-850-8919. That's area code 213-850-8919. You can also call area code 310. That's 310-454-6034. That's 310-454-6034. And now, folks, I take you to the Embassy Suites in Phoenix, Arizona, the Motel from Hell. Probably all heard the news by now. And without any further ado, I'm going to let you hear some recordings of tapes, or tapes with recordings of telephone calls which I made from the hotel room during this incident on a cellular phone. Unbeknownst to me, patriots and other people in Phoenix, Arizona, we're listening on scanners and rebroadcasting what was happening, my exact telephone calls, over CB radio throughout the Phoenix area. Thanks to them, I'm here tonight. Now, as you listen to these telephone conversations, Remember that these are just snatches of many conversations during that evening. I spoke variously to television, radio, newspapers. I spoke to patriots up here where I live. I spoke to Gene Miller and many other people. Basically, aside from people that I knew and patriots, nobody gave a damn what was happening to us except one reporter who worked for the Mesa Tribune. He was the only one who listened. He's the only one who cared. He's the only one who showed up. And I'm sure that he wrote a story, although had no contact with him. It was not published in his paper, probably due to the editors culling it out. Now, as you listen to these phone conversations, ladies and gentlemen, you're going to have to listen hard because remember they were recorded off of scanners and off of CB radios, and the tapes were sent to me by people I don't even know. Don't know their names, don't know where they're from, nothing. I know nothing about them. I don't even know where these tapes came from. I can tell you, though, that they are authentic, and I thank all those people who took the time to listen, to record, to show up, to make sure that the police didn't do anything that they shouldn't do, and even then, they did. But they probably saved my life. We had already been guests. Me, Annie, and Pooh. Pooh is 4 years old. 4 years old. The most wonderful little girl that you could ever meet in your life, even if she's my daughter, it's true. There's no reason why any of this happened. And when you listen, remember that we have been gassed. Our throats are raw and burning. Our nasal passages are raw and burning. Our eyes are watering. And we are all breathing through wet towels, which we have over our face, our nose, and our mouth. So the voice you hear is not going to sound very much like me. Also remember, we were very, very tired. And there was a certain element of extreme worry. I was very, very worried about Annie and Pooh. And of course, Annie and Pooh were very, very scared. So pay close attention, folks. Listen very, very carefully.
For many years, this is just going to happen someday. That's exactly what's happening.
This is a long-distance phone call with a friend of mine in where I live. Yeah, I have a cellular phone right here.
Who is that you're speaking to, though?
The guy at the newspaper. I'll tell you what, I'm going to hook you guys together right here, and you guys have a short conversation. Because the guy at the newspaper wonders who you are, Scott, and you're wondering who he is. So you guys talk for a couple of minutes. I'm going to pull the phones apart and whatever.
You can pass me across there, can you?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Can you hear me?
That didn't work, folks.
Scott.
Yeah.
Hey, there.
Hey, yeah.
Hold on. Just hold on, okay?
Yeah. Yeah, Annie? Hmm? Are you still by there?
Yeah.
Okay. Can you tell Annie what the nature of the problem is here? Did they wake you guys up, or you were apparently awake when they hit the door, or?
I think they kicked the door. I think they banged on the door, made a loud noise. I mean, the fool was sleeping.
Right.
Apparently, they wake us up. Then all of a sudden, the gas, couldn't breathe.
Yeah.
Don't worry about the pool. I don't worry about anything else. I don't know what else is going on, you know?
Okay, have you heard any voices, or did you hear them yelling there to identify who they were, or what they're there for?
No, just bang the door, and I don't know what's really happened there.
Bill was telling me that that's the Phoenix PD police department that's there. Have you seen anything that would indicate that that's the police department that's outside the door?
No, I didn't go out and look. I don't know. I really don't know what. All I know is a big bang on the door, knocking the door. And I didn't go out look. I just stayed in the room.
Yeah, but pretty much you can hear inside the room. You didn't hear a voice that identified the people outside at all, right?
The air condition was down. I really can't hear nothing, so I already don't know. Sorry to tell you, but the air condition was noisy. Couldn't hear any. Well, I hear a big noise. Crash. So, oh, God, this is bad.
And how long after Bill got back to the room did this occur?
5 minutes.
So obviously somebody followed him back from the hotel bar then?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay.
So I can hear you locking the door. And 5 minutes later, someone's banging on the door. We didn't open the door. I don't want to open the door because, you know.
Right, no.
You don't know who the outside.
All right.
You open the door, so.
Right, no.
They tried 3 times.
Right, don't open it. We'll have to try to get a hold of the desk. First, and I did try to identify who it is outside. Now, do you have any? Can you tell if anybody's still out there right now?
Oh, I don't want to go look. Go see, you know. If I go, look, it might shoot me.
No, I mean just by sounds and so forth. You don't hear anybody. Are you on the first ground floor, or are you on a upstairs floor?
I'm sorry, Bill was talking to me. Would you say that again?
Are you on the ground floor, or are you on one of the stories up?
No, second.
Second story?
Yeah.
You can't hear anybody moving around in the catwalk outside steps or anything? Footsteps?
No, I can't.
No movement out there?
No, it's like very quiet right now.
Okay.
But the room's full of gas.
It still is?
Yeah.
Okay, the air conditioner's not taking care of it?
No, the air condition was shut off.
What is the window open? How did they get the gas inside the room?
They must have through the vent. You know, I don't know. I really don't know what to tell you about the living gas for sure.
Okay.
The only thing I worry about is cool, you know, she feels so bad.
Yeah.
Well,
now is it starting to clear out at all, the air?
Mm-mm.
Are there no?
Still.
Okay.
We'll talk to you, okay?
Okay.
Scott.
Yeah, Bill.
We're not leaving this room unless we got patriots here to escort us out. We're not walking out of this room.
Okay.
I can't give a shit what.
Right. Now, I was just questioning Eddie as to is there gas continuously being fed in?
No, there was a tremendous amount of gas came in at one point. And we were all just almost incapacitated.
So
I showed Annie and Pooh how to protect themselves. And then it abated. And I called the front desk and threatened them with lawsuit and every other thing in the world. And there were Phoenix police officers outside the door. And now the phone's ringing again. Hold on. Hello. Yeah. Yeah, I don't know what's going to happen here. I don't know. The last time I looked, there were Phoenix police officers outside the door, and I don't know what's going on, Gene. Okay. All right.
Gene Miller's coming down. We tried to get hold of Craig Smith, but we couldn't. I'm telling you right now, I'm not walking out of this room unless I know that there is a protection of Arizona Patriots there to make sure that we get the hell out of the city.
Right.
And
now they still haven't voiced or announced anything outside the door.
No.
Do you have a peephole on the door?
Yeah, we do.
Have you tried that?
We've looked out, and all we can see is like people standing on the periphery, and we can't tell who the hell they are or what they're doing. I called the desk, and the desk is denied all responsibility and anything to do with it, and they said that they don't know what's going on, and I mean, this is absolutely ridiculous.
Right, but they confirm, though, that it is Phoenix PD outside the door. Okay. That's amazing. All right, now, so, Baptists already down there in that area before he...
No, he's a metal salesman. He doesn't have any contact with anybody other than that.
Then I take it there's a message in to Craig Smith, all right?
Yeah, but Gene said that he wasn't able to contact him because he's out of town.
Okay. And this is the first contact you were able to have with Gene Miller?
Yeah.
Okay.
Except earlier this evening, we were all supposed to go to dinner together.
Right.
Then Gene called, and we just got in about 5:30 or 6, talked to Gene and said we were all really tired, and we just wanted to relax, you know?
Yeah.
And so we called off going out to dinner.
Right, right. Canceled the plans.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. The thing to do would be to have Gene get in contact with me. How long is it going to take? Well, you're down on Thomas. As a matter of fact, you're on that's East Thomas, 2333 East Thomas, right? All right.
Right next to Swampy Park.
All right. Me.
Yeah, that's true.
And that's what we need to do at this time. See, we've got to have somebody on the outside that can tell what the hell's going on here. You have a situation where the assailants, you got to assume that's what they are, aren't even identified. We don't even know for sure that they're PD. You know, they could be anybody.
That's true.
And now you've got a desk that basically isn't even communicating with you, right?
Won't communicate at all, those bastards. They won't even try to communicate or say what's going on or who the hell is doing what.
Right.
For what even reason.
All right. Now, the only next step that I can think of, though, would be to kind of, have you attempted yourself to contact Phoenix PD?
No.
Well, that would be the next step, because you're definitely in Phoenix City jurisdiction.
Well, I heard from Gene, he was going to come down here and call me from the hotel.
Okay. All right. As soon as he does that, ask Gene to get in contact with me so that I can get a clearer description of exactly what kind of force is outside your room.
Okay.
Now, is there, there's no rear exit to the room, right?
No. No, the rear exit is like, we're on the second floor. I mean, I could jump down in the parking lot.
Right.
But I haven't even explored that or even looked out that direction because I don't want to be a fugitive, number one. And number two, I really can't conceive of a police department being so fucking stupid as to even ignore that kind of a thing. But, you know, that could be absolutely the case, is that there's nobody out there. But if I jump down there, I mean, if it was after tomorrow morning, I would have my new leg and everything would be fine. But right now I don't, and I probably would not be able to get away with it.
Well, you don't want to go jumping on any sand.
I don't want to be a fugitive anyway. I mean, there's right. No reason for this to be happening at all.
Well, the main reason for my question about the rear exit or rear windows, Bill, is to examine it for a potential assault from the rear. And not as an escape route, but just what might be going on at the rear. That's why I ask that.
You know my philosophy. If it comes down to it, there will be no running away or anything. If it comes right down to it, I will negotiate a release of Annie and Pooh, and I will make my stand right here.
Right.
There will be no compromise on my part for any reason whatsoever. I've done nothing wrong. I will just never do anything like that.
Right.
Come to the room. Next thing I know, we're being attacked by the police. And, you know...
And that was within about 5 minutes of your arrival back at the room.
Yeah.
That you arrived at the
room. Absolutely. I never did anything to anybody. I never refused to pay my bill. I never attacked anybody. I never assaulted anybody. I never hit anybody. Nothing.
Did you have a beast on you when you were down there?
No. No.
Okay. All right.
No, not at all.
All right. Okay. This is getting stranger as we go along, but
well,
really is.
I've warned you guys, these people have been watching me for a long time. They've just been waiting for something to happen. I don't know what's going on. I don't know who instigated it. I don't know why this is happening.
Right.
It should never have happened at all.
See, it is. We just barely caught me. We got your registration as your right name.
Yeah.
So we got to assume that somebody at the hotel aroused all this attention for you.
Either that or some outside force that has bribed some people or done something. I don't know what. But there is no reason for any of this.
If that's the case, then...
And the hotel now seems to be covering up the fact that they gassed us.
Well, that's right. That's what I'm beginning to piece together. In other words, they had something to do with the crime, you know, the cops in the first place. And so, therefore, that's why they've terminated all communication with you, and there's no assistance.
Right.
Because they were in on it, to start with. All right, now I'm trying to estimate Gene's time of arrival, because all I got to go on is the assumption, not knowing where he lives, that he's way out north, somewhere near that office. Well, as soon as we got them identified by, let's say, Gene, we're going to have to assume that it'll be Gene identifying them, then there will be contact made. But in the interim, I don't think it's advisable to do that, because it's liable to bring heat down where there may not particularly... We don't even know for sure that that's Phoenix PD represented out on your catwalk there.
Well, if I had tape recorders that I could hook up to the phone line, I'd talk to anybody.
Yeah.
But I don't.
Right. Okay, now, while we've been hashing this over, have you heard any further activity or movement outside?
Absolutely not.
Are you getting any shadows from the rot lights out there?
Nothing. Yeah, I've told Poonay to stay away from the windows and everything. We'll just play it cool.
All right, now, I had asked Danny this. She wasn't sure. How did they get the gas you mentioned at the end of the room?
Oh, I have no idea. I don't know. One minute everything was okay, the next minute we were flooded with like pepper gas. It wasn't tear gas.
Yeah.
It wasn't CS gas, it was pepper gas.
Right. It's a high irritant.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. Skin's irritated and so forth, right?
And coughing and the whole works.
Okay.
It was really very unpleasant for quite a while.
Right. Up here, so in the meantime, I'll wake a couple of others and have them standing by.
Good.
And we'll wait to hear from either you or Gene.
Are the police still there?
The police are outside the room, as far as I know. We refuse to open the door. They have not said any warrant or any
Uncle William Cooper.
Lord, what a sure.
Check. What did they get?
Seems to me like pepper gas.
Hello? Okay. I'll get a hold of Meg right away. I should be able to call into your room here.
Yeah, sure.
I'm calling.
Room 230.
All right.
Have Greg call me if he can get through. I don't know if they'll let him get through, but if he can, let him call me.
Okay.
Okay?
All right.
Bye.
Bye. Wow. Didn't that sound like William Cooper?
He said it was Bill.
He sounded like William Cooper, man, and he said Pooh and Annie, and he called his kid Pooh, and his old lady's name is Annie, right?
Yeah, that just wasn't clicking.
Duh, that was Bill Cooper.
You know what happened? He said earlier he was in a fight with somebody in a bar or kind of a disagreement. Oh, and their line's still open. That's weird. The line's still open.
Apparently he goes around the countryside raising hell.
Oh yeah, they're gonna call somebody here. This is the second or third call he's made. He called somebody else and somebody was acting like they didn't care. I thought he would give out the cell number. I'd like to call him up. So you need some help?
He's in room 230.
He is in room 230. What is that? The embassy suites over there, isn't it?
I don't know. 2333 East Thomas.
Yeah, I think that's embassy suites right there. It is. Oh, it's positive. That's embassy suites.
Well, it sure sounded like Bill Cooper's voice.
Yeah, now that you said that, man, I'm just about flipping out because he did say Pooh and Annie, and that just, man, it didn't click when he said it.
Who's Bill Cooper?
He's the guy on the radio that has the show from 9 to 10 every night.
You're kidding me? No.
Oh.
But he did say that he got in a disagreement with somebody in a bar about politics.
Wow.
I swear to God, that was the first call he was trying to explain to somebody that he had gotten in a disagreement with somebody over the over politics. And he's just not trying to leave. And the next day, another cop's here, and I've been sprayed.
Wow.
You know, we couldn't have recorded that, huh? He thinks that that he's not going to get out. He's trying to call as many people as he can.
I'm about ready to get in my car and go down there.
Here it is,
Bill Cooper.
Yeah. It is Bill Cooper.
In a motel room in,
He said it's Bill Cooper. Did you hear that?
Yeah.
Uh-huh. And we're surrounded by law enforcement, and, they've already gassed us with pepper gas. Me and Annie and Pooh.
What?
And, I don't know what to do, but, we need help, my friend.
What?
We need help with media. We need help with talk radio talk shows. We need help with everything because I'm not going out.
Yep. Oh, my.
I don't know why they wouldn't tell me why, nor would they tell me where he was going. All they would say was that he knew why.
Well, I tell you where he's going. He's going down to from Madison Jail. That's exactly where he's going.
That's exactly what I told you I was supposed to call. That's what I told him. I said they wouldn't tell me where he was going. But I have about a 90% probability that I know where he's going. He's at Madison Street Jail. And probably Pooh and Annie are at Good Sam being looked at because they were sprayed with gas.
They did spray him?
They sprayed all of them, yeah.
What the hell?
Wow.
Why, can't you? Well, that's a big deal. You don't think he ain't going to pinch a dish on the air about that one?
Oh, big time, I'm sure, yeah. If he doesn't just accidentally commit suicide by now.
Yeah, if he hadn't accidentally beat his brains in on the bar trying to escape.
Right, exactly.
Man, I feel old.
Hey, check me, Dr. Bell. That is my story.
But, what did Linda Thompson say? She called you back?
No, she hasn't called back, and all I could do was leave a message on her machine, you know, so I don't know. We'll see when she, if and when she calls back.
Yeah, I wish you knew that number. Tina Hartzell knows that number. They contact her directly. Obviously, you don't want to have anything on that about that out there, so one reason or another. But I'd be interested. I don't know if William Cooper would appreciate it or not.
Yeah, I'm not sure I should call her, so I thought about that, but I just don't know that that's the right thing to do. I figure he may be able to get a hold of her, but I don't know. I just don't want to go on the air and tell my all that bullshit. I just, I don't know. If I thought I should, I would, but I'm not sure that I should.
Hey, Chuck.
What?
I got in weeks to deal with this. What happened? Is that
so?
Oh, no.
William Cooper.
Gotta get on frequency.
He doesn't even know who William Cooper is, so he's the guy that I keep trying to tell you to listen to a shortwave.
Get on frequency, Bill.
Oh, is somebody sprayed with gas?
What?
Right. And then arrested him, and, well, they sprayed him, his wife, and his daughter with gas, and he got arrested, and his wife and daughter were taken somewhere, and he didn't know, and I don't know where they are.
Well, I'll bet you they took his wife and his kid down to Humana, which is right there by Shaw Peak. That's where the three cars must have been rushing when I seen them.
Maybe so. I told the people that I thought they usually take prisoners to Good Samaritan to be checked out, and since his daughter was sprayed with gas and she's only about 6 years old, that they're probably at Good Sam. I didn't think about Humana.
Yeah, Humana's right there at the Squaw Peak, just a block and a half away there.
Yeah,
it's right there right off the road, right on Thomas and Squaw Peak.
Hey, Chuck, when did this happen?
About, well, it started at 11:30. I got there at 12:35.
You got where?
Embassy Suites Hotel.
Well, I was about the same time I was there.
I was there. Maybe I was there when you were there, but I was standing right out in front. I was right with the cops, standing right next to the car where they had Bill Cooper talking to him through the window.
What were you wearing?
I was wearing a green t-shirt and Levi's.
I didn't see it.
You had to have been pulling up just as I was leaving.
I know a fella who lives down the block. His elevator don't go quite to the top. Works out at the middle mall where everybody shops. Step out of line, cause he's here to take a bite out of shopping mall crime. Yeah, 10-4, got a little problem in the parking lot here. 10-4, roger now. No, I'll handle it. Look at that fella parking that handicap spot. He don't have a sticker on his car any place. Saw me coming, started running, so I shot him in the toe. I yelled, "Hey, you handicapped now, boy. You don't have to go." "Hey, you quit hopping around there for a minute, I'll give you a temporary fix." "What's wrong with you?" He wrapped on his chin and shoot one bullet in his room. He saunters down the sidewalk, hit the spark, fly just for fun. All the little kids marble and the teenagers run. Ain't gonna be no crime when the super cop is done. Super cop, yeah, he's always on guard. Super cop, believe him, coming down hard. Super cop, law enforcement every night. He's got an autograph picture of him. Barney Fife. Buford here. Yeah, I'm in the grocery store, got another. No, I don't need no bathroom.
Buford White, that is. Officer White of the Phoenix Police Scam Department.
You know she's only loud now. "Hey, ma'am, guess I'm just going to have to run you and all these little crumb grabbers down town. Or you can drink that bottle of corn all there and get your count back." Just a little more. Come on. Now, don't it feel good to know you're legal? Got a 6-3. GMC. Daddy hand painted black and white. So watch team clothes and nobody knows where he got that black and police light. 10-4, back in the parking lot. Yeah, got a little 11-22 in the rockers. I got it under control. Look, parking that fire lane. Shiny new Corvette. I'll teach that little hot rodder lesson he won't soon forget. Now, most cops are just riding a ticket or put a wheel lock on his car. Not me, I'll strike a match, put it in the gas tank. Set it on call. Make the funny for this crime, I always say. That way to learn by association. Oh, Lord, I didn't know fire like a burn like that. Look at that. I bet when the flame shows out, it looks like a big log of lump. Super cop. He's got his signs on you. Super cop. You better watch out what you do. Super cop. Now don't step out of line, cause I'm here to take a bite. Shopping mall crime. Super cop, I'm leaving, coming down hard. Oh, here comes that lady I made drink that cornhole. Looks like she's in a hurry. Restroom? Yes, ma'am. Just go down aisle 9 there and turn left. Oops. Need a cleanup on aisle 9. Aisle 10. 11. ever saw a grocery store empty out the tag. We ain't even got no checkout people left. I wish I had another quote.
There wasn't a vehicle like yours parked in front of Jerry's when I pulled up, because I thought about parking there, and I noticed there was no vehicle like yours there. There was one or like a Honda car there, maybe some other car, and that was it. But there were like four spaces open. I thought about parking there, but I decided to pull around back and kind of case it out first.
Yeah, I can't see from behind off of 24th through Gosnell Development there, because I know you can get there, there, and I figured they'd be all over the front, but I came in through the back, didn't see anything, and came up around behind Jerry's and see all the cops in the world there, and then just as I pulled around to the front and parked right next to that Honda-looking thing, I seen, all just, there were six cop cars there, and some other blue thing that looked like, I don't know what, and some guy with a white shirt with like shoulder patches on it. I don't know who the hell that guy was. But shortly after that, three of them got out of there real quickly and went down towards Squaw Peak, which should have been transporting his wife and his kid. I don't know, but I don't know who the guy with the white shirt with the little pad thing, or I guess he had to do something with the. He kept talking to the cops. I don't know what information he was giving them, but he looked like a bus boy or something, I don't know what.
Oh, I didn't see that. Boy, I'm trying to figure out if you were there and left before I got there, or if you were there after I was there, because when I was there, I mean, according to what you're saying, you should have saw me and Bill Cooper and the cops all walk out the front door of Embassy Suites at the same time. I was the first one in line. They let me walk with him out of there. I was about 5 feet from him, walking backwards, talking fast the whole way. And I walked right out that front door, and they put him in the second police car there. There was one in front of his, and there was about six cop cars there. I was there for probably 10, 15 more minutes, I would think, there until they just seemed to hold him there a long time, and I told him I was going to wait there and see to it that he got out of there in one piece, and it just started appearing like they were whispering over there about possibly doing something with me, and I just told him I think I better go now, and he said, yeah, I go, and call those people, and so I left, and he was still in the cop car in front of the place when I left. That may be when you pulled up.
That probably was, because there was two cops that were the second car back where there was two pulled in closer to Jerry's, one up against the curbing there close to the hotel, and then another one sitting out there a little bit further. Some blonde-headed looking cop with a pudgy face looking fuck. He kept looking your way, and it looked like they wanted to come over and ask him out of nowhere, and we got out of the van and walked over towards the side gate, which you used to be able to go into, and had card access on it, so I couldn't get in there anymore, because the key I had wouldn't work, and card access now. And I was going to go right up there and take a look at 230, because I've been in there lots of times doing different things, but they locked you out on the outside perimeter gate, so I didn't appreciate that. I don't like that.
That's basically, I walked up to the same gate, saw I couldn't get in, and went right around and right in the front entrance. And when you go in there, there's like a courtyard. And right when I walked into the courtyard, they were just basically forcing the door open right then, and that's when I started yelling.
Yeah, I know the courtyard's closed now. 230 would have been on the west side?
It was, yeah, I guess west side, second floor.
Why don't you just listen up, Elliot? You'll learn more this way.
So I was looking at it along the outside, because he was talking about on the scanner there about going out on the balcony or something. That would have been interesting.
No, there was no balcony in the rear, if you notice, just the window down to the parking lot.
Mm-hmm.
I scoped it all out. I went around like you did and checked the outside perimeter first and then went in.
Hey, Chuck?
Yeah.
Can you tell the story that makes some sense to get it laid out of here? Who poured gasoline? Why was he arrested? Who broke into what?
Gasoline, Jesus.
The fuck?
Well, no one poured gasoline. It was pepper spray or something along those lines, you know, like mace or something. And
And he was on the cellular phone asking for help, and he told who he was and everything, and said he was surrounded by police in a motel room, and that he wasn't coming out until he was surrounded by patriots to escort him out. And I hopped in my car and beelined down there, and I got there just as they were bringing him out, and I started yelling at the police, telling them that they better not hurt him, and that I was there to see to it that he gets wherever he's going in one piece. And they would not tell me what the charges were, and they would not tell me where they were taking him, and they would not tell me where his wife and daughter were. So that brings you up to where we started.
Well, the police is the ones that are taking
him. Right.
Well, this guy's pretty quick. If he was what, just there at the Sweeney, was he there to give a talk or what?
He was there for whatever reason. He was just a guest in the motel.
And they wouldn't see what he was arrested for.
No, I asked if they had a warrant. They said, no, there's not a warrant necessary in this case. This is what's called an OV arrest. Do you know what that is? That's what he said. He said, if I want to know what the charges are, I should contact the FBI. And I said, is he under federal charges, under arrest by the FBI? They said, no. And I said, well, your city of Phoenix police, is he under arrest by the city of Phoenix? And they said, no. He's under the arrest by the state of Arizona. And I said, that your city of Phoenix police officer is correct? And he said, yes. And I knew anyway, and I said, so where is he going to be taken? And they said, I can't tell you that. I'll be in a lot of trouble, and I can't tell you that. And I said, well, I've never heard of that. Usually you can at least find out what jail they're taking him to so someone could bail him out or whatever. And he said, I can't tell you any of that. Like I told you before, you should contact the FBI. And I said, I don't know anything about the FBI or any of that stuff. All I'm telling you is I'm here as a citizen to see to it that you do your job and you see to it that his constitutional rights are followed and that he gets where he's going.
Are you there, William?
Yeah, I'm here.
Folks, this is William. I'm not going to tell you his last name. He's not the person who made this tape, but he's one of the people that you heard talking on this tape tonight. William, can you tell us what happened from the time that you got there until the time that you left?
Okay. Well, when I got there, like I said, I pulled up, looked at Jerry's. There's a restaurant right next door to the west of it. I looked at Jerry's restaurant, thought about parking there. There were cops galore all over. I pulled around back, and I didn't see any cops around the rear, so I pulled up and parked behind Jerry's. Then I went around to this side gate and saw that they had it locked so you couldn't get in there. So I didn't think they would let me in there, but I just was going to go until they, you know, until I couldn't go any farther. And I ended up just basically making it just through the lobby, and that's when they were bringing you out. And that's when I started yelling at them, telling them that I was here to see to it that you got out of there in one piece, and started questioning them about whether they had the proper warrants and so forth, which, as you heard, I didn't get any of that information out of them, but I was trying. And then I stood there, and of course you and I conversed as to the instructions you gave me that you wanted me to do, and as far as who you wanted me to call and so forth. And I told the police that if they ever did anything in their life, they better see to it that you get where you're going in one piece. And when they kept holding you there so long, I, you know, couldn't figure out why they weren't taking you away. And I just sensed that they were over there definitely talking about me. And I thought that if I don't go now, I'm not going at all, or I'm going to be in the car behind you. And I didn't figure I could do you any good there. So that's when I told you I think I should go now. And so I went to my car. They didn't follow me to my car, nor did they follow me out of there. As I left there, I knew that I wanted so bad to follow the cop car when it left there, but I just knew that I couldn't. Little did I know that that Richard would pull up right when I left, which he did, and apparently he was there to, even though he didn't come right out front, he was sitting there watching the whole time from where I left off. So that's basically what I saw while I was there in a nutshell.
What was my condition?
You seem to be fine, coherent, rational, logical. You seemed like it was a combination of everything, I thought, stress. I thought you looked like Walter Matthau. Your hair was kind of curly, and it was basically you looked fine to me. You looked like someone that was just definitely worn out, and your eyes were all bugged out and watery. I could tell that. And you seemed kind of, I don't know, I knew that you wouldn't quite know who I was at first, and I really didn't expect you to just, greet me with open arms. I knew you would be reserved about anyone that approached you, but I was just, trying to do the best I could. You looked fine to me, though.
Great. Well, I'm sure that, I'm sure I must have been a mess because we were in that room a long time with that gas, and it was a terrible experience. But you took a great risk when you came out there to help me, and I realize that, and I have a great emotional feelings toward you, William. I got to tell you that right now. I really thank you for what you did. Did you see the reporter from the Tribune there?
No, I didn't. He apparently showed up just after I left because from what, and I did talk to him the next day, and he said that he was there until you went away and that you did go away in a City of Phoenix car.
Uh-huh.
I was worried that they would transfer you to another vehicle. That was the main reason I was trying to stay there. Anyway, so thank you, and I would do it any time again. I was scared to death when I left to go down there, but I was listening to it. I felt like you were in the water. I was standing on the side. No one else would know what was going on. I was the chosen one, and it was my duty, and so I just reached down and just did it.
Well, I'm certainly glad that you did. I know it took great courage, and I know that you were afraid, and I know that you did. I watched you challenge the police repeatedly to try to get information to the point where you could have got arrested yourself. And I was listening when the police officer said to call the FBI if you wanted further information. So we know that the FBI was involved in this in some way. It's also very strange that the police officer said that if he told you where he was taking me, that he could get in trouble. I remember him saying that too. Also, as we pulled away, I asked him, what does the FBI have to do with this? And he completely ignored me. They did not take me to the Madison Street or the Maricopa County Jail. They took me someplace where there was nobody. It was like an abandoned building. There was the cop that drove me down there, and then there was another police officer who showed up. They had to unlock the door. They had to turn on the lights. There was nobody in there whatsoever, and they took me down and put me in this little bitty cell. And they had put the handcuffs on so tight that it cut off the blood in both of my hands. And for about 2 hours, I had no circulation or very little circulation in my hands. I must have had some. I wouldn't have any hands now. But I had no feeling in my right hand and very little feeling in my left hand because of that. And I'll be going to the doctor tomorrow to get this looked at. I thought that this would be something that would go away, but it's not going away. And now I'm beginning to worry about it.
I know the feeling. Well, actually, I think you've got bruised nerves and it'll come back, but it'll take about a month. I've had a similar problem.
Well, I have this deep rage inside for what they did to Annie and Pooh. Pooh's 4 years old. Annie certainly didn't do anything, and all I was guilty of was getting in an argument with some people in the bar who were baiting me and trying to get me into a fight where I would hit somebody. And when I realized what they were doing, I refrained from that. So,
right. Well, the man from the Mesa Tribune told me that the police did acknowledge using gas. That he was wondering about. Two, he wanted to know why everyone in the world was ready to run to the aid of Bill Cooper, and who's Bill Cooper. I told him, you don't know who Bill Cooper is? Told him you better tune in. But 3, he said he's never seen so many officers' 8 cars called to a just a simple disturbance as it was supposed to be.
Yeah, well, I've never seen anything like that either. In fact, I don't think anybody's ever seen like what happened to us in the Motel from Hell, the Embassy Suites. And certainly hope you people out there will remember that the Embassy Suites is the Motel from Hell and refrain from patronizing that scuzzbag place. But, you know, again, William, I want to thank you. And I know that there's a lot of people out there who would like to thank you also. And
certainly welcome anytime. No problem.
We can't give out your last name for obvious reasons. We don't want you to be hassled or harassed by the police. And I'm going to go to court on September the 1st if they decide to press charges, which I don't see how they can. They have no charges to press. And the reason they held me at the hotel for so long is they were trying to figure out what to charge me with. When they arrested me, when they stormed through the door, they told me that I was under arrest for assaulting a police officer. And that was absolutely ridiculous because there's no way that I had assaulted a police officer. And they all knew that. So they held me there for a long, long time, and that's what you were wondering about, because they were trying to figure out how to charge me and what to charge me with. But this was obviously set up from the beginning. 8 police cars. You should have seen how many police officers were there, folks. If you doubt that we're going into a police state, I hope to God that this doesn't ever happen to you and your family, because it was a terrifying experience, and I'm still not sure how this has affected little Pooh, but I'm sure that we're going to find out in the next few weeks and months. She's already had a few nightmares. I don't know if it was over this or it was normal nightmares that children have, but it will either manifest itself or she'll be strong enough to overcome this experience. I don't know which it's going to be. Thank you, William, for being a guest tonight, and thank you for showing up there, and thank you for telling the truth and having the courage to do it.
No problem. It was a privilege and an honor, and can I thank the people that helped get the tapes together and bring all this to where I could hear it, and just all the people that had anything to do with it, which would be Lance, Byron, Ron, let's see, Richard, and Bob. These people were key in this all coming together.
Great. And I want to ask them all, first I want to thank them all for what they did and for taping that and for being concerned. And I want to caution all of you to preserve those tapes and don't in any way let me know who you are. I don't want to know who you are, because if they get me on the stand and ask me, I'll have to tell the truth, because that's the kind of person I am. And I don't want to be able to tell them who has those tapes, because they might disappear. So please don't let anybody else, or don't let me know who you are. I don't want to know. Preserve those tapes, and if we ever need them, I'll let you know over this broadcast, and then you can send them to the proper people without ever letting anybody know who you are. So thank you all. We'll preserve your privacy and your identity, and we'll certainly keep you from being harassed and bothered by these New World Order Gestapo scumbags. Good night, William.
Good night.
Folks, I want you to understand that we're getting down to the wire. It wasn't too long ago that Linda Thompson was arrested. Last Wednesday night, the 17th, I was arrested after being very, very smartly set up and not thinking right. I fell into it in the beginning. Being a person who does not run from an argument, I got into an argument with these people who baited me. But I did figure out what they were doing at the point where they tried to get me to come to blows with them, and I was smart enough to leave. This won't happen again, I can assure you. I will be a lot smarter next time, and I will be a lot more prepared, and I will make sure that I have a good security force with me wherever I go, including Los Angeles, on the 3rd and 4th of September at the L.A. Airport Marina Hotel. If you want information about that, call area code 213-850-8919. That's area code 213-850-8919, or area code 310. That's area code 310-454-6034. That's area code 310-454-6034. That's September 3rd and 4th, the L.A. Los Angeles Airport Marina Hotel for the Extraordinary Experiences Research Expo. There'll be some good speakers there. There'll also be some flakes there that show up. You'll have a good time either way. Folks, I want to tell you from the bottom of my heart, I thank each and every one of you who have called, who have been concerned, who helped in some way. All of you who called the Phoenix Police Department that night, you put the fear of God into them, and they treated me with great respect, especially after they found my commission in the Second Continental Army of the Republic in my wallet, and after all the calls that you all made. Linda Thompson, I thank you very much for your efforts and for your contacting of the bondsman, and Tim Lesperance, who provided the money, and all the other people and the patriots across this country who were arming themselves and getting ready to start the restoration of the Republic simply because I had been arrested. Thank you. Thank God for you. God bless you. God save the Republic, and good night.
All of a sudden, in the middle of the night, there's a loud knock on your door. Hey, honey, something's not right.
Close your arms. It's Temple Master. We're here from the government. We're here to help you.
I'm from the IRS with a power to tax. If you've got a complaint, stay in the back.
Get out of this house. Surrender your guns. Give me your gold. If they will pay you to want it from me, dance the good stuff and do what you're told.
Hillary Salon, Reno Janet Dyke, reading the words of General Albert Pike, demonic founder of the Ku Klux Klan, engineer of the Masonic Master Plan. Pike said Lucifer is godlike across this land. And Clinton saying take the mark in your right hand. While we're all dancing with the drums of uproar right, let's prepare this for another huge tax hike. Order out of chaos, aggression, inflation, create the panic and rape the nation. Crisis creation, incite black and white, program agitation. But it's not you. Iron Mountain, computer beast, and cattle mutilations. Black projects, UFOs,
and weird genetic combinations.
The Nazi doctors didn't die. Come on, get here. They came here with the OSS through Operation Paperclip. National ID, debit card? Yeah. Vaccination, biochip, milk carton kits.
Genetic engineering.
Clinton says her health plans for you and your own
good.
Sure. And Adolf Hitler's Robin Hood. Sonic mind manipulation. Inciting riots.
It's crisis creation.
Biochip implantation. Vaccinate your kid for UN identification.
This is a test for all of us. So I have today just one simple request. A comprehensive package of healthcare benefits that are always there and can never be taken away, never be taken away.
Atmospheric, social illusion, media hype, planned confusion,
Masonic religion, it's a lie. Not your brain, for a Luciferian Messiah.